Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Networking for Dummies, 11th edition, by Doug Lowe. Narrated by David Stifel. Introduction. Welcome to the 11th edition of Networking for Dummies, the book that's written especially for people who have this nagging feeling in the back of their minds that they should network their computers, but haven't a clue about how to start or where to begin. Do you often copy a spreadsheet to a flash drive just so you can give it to someone else in your office? Are you frustrated because you can't use the fancy color laser printer that's on the financial secretary's computer? Do you wait in line to use the computer that has the customer database? You need a network. Or maybe you already have a network, but you have just one problem. Someone promised that a network would make your life easier, but it's instead turned your computing life upside down. Just when you had this computer thing figured out, someone popped into your office, hooked up a cable, and said, "Happy networking!" Makes you want to scream. Regardless, you've found the right book. Help is here. This book talks about networks in everyday and often irreverent terms. The language is friendly. You don't need a graduate education to get through it. And the occasional potshot helps unseat the hallowed and sacred traditions of networkdom, bringing just a bit of fun to an otherwise dry subject. The goal is to bring the lofty precepts of networking down to earth, where you can touch them and squeeze them and say, "What's the big deal? I can do this." About this book. This isn't the kind of book you pick up and listen from start to finish, as if it were a cheap novel. If I ever see you listening to it at the beach, I'll kick sand in your face. This book is more like a reference, the kind of book you can start listening to at any point. Each chapter covers a specific aspect of networking, such as printing from the network, hooking up network cables, or setting up security so that bad guys can't break in. Just go to the chapter you're interested in and start listening. Each chapter is divided into self-contained chunks, all related to the major theme of the chapter. For example, the chapter on hooking up the network cable contains nuggets like these. What is Ethernet? All about cable. To shield or not to shield. Wall jacks and patch panels. Switches. You don't have to memorize anything in this book. It's a need-to-know book. You pick it up when you need to know something. Need to know what 100 base T is? Listen to the book. Need to know how to create good passwords? Listen to the book. Otherwise, get on with your life. Foolish assumptions. I'm making only two assumptions about who you are. You're someone who works with a PC, and you either have a network or you're thinking about getting one. I hope that you know and are on speaking terms with someone who knows more about computers than you do. My goal is to decrease your reliance on that person, but don't throw away his phone number yet. Is this book useful for Macintosh users? Absolutely. Although the bulk of this book is devoted to showing you how to link Windows-based computers to form a network, you can find information about how to network Macintosh computers as well. Windows 10? Got you covered. You'll find plenty of information about how to network with the latest and greatest Microsoft desktop operating system. Windows Server 2016? No worries. You'll find plenty of information about the newest version of Microsoft's server operating system. Icons used in this book. Those nifty little icons in the margin aren't there just to pretty up the place. They also have practical functions. Technical stuff. Hold it. Technical details lurk just around the corner. Listen if you have a pocket protector. Tip: pay special attention to this icon. It lets you know that some particularly useful tidbit is at hand. Perhaps a shortcut or a little used command that pays off big. Remember. Did I tell you about the memory course I took? Warning. Danger, Will Robinson. This icon highlights information that may help you avoid disaster. Beyond the book. In addition to the material in the print or ebook you're hearing right now, this product also comes with some Access Anywhere goodies on the web. Check out the free cheat sheet for links to useful websites for networking information, private IP address ranges for networks, and more. To get this cheat sheet, simply go to dummies.com and type Networking for Dummies Cheat Sheet in the search box. Where to go from here? Yes, you can get there from here. With this book, you're ready to plow right through the rugged networking terrain. Be bold, be courageous, be adventurous. Above all, have fun. Part 1. Getting started with networking. In this part, find out what a network is and what you can do with one. Compare server and client computers. Access network resources, such as shared storage and network printers. Use Microsoft Office and other software on a network. Chapter 1. Let's network. In this chapter, getting a handle on networks, considering why networking is useful and is everywhere, telling the difference between servers and clients, looking under the hood of the network operating system, asking, how does it work when a network works if a network works for me? Say what? Assessing how networks change computing life, identifying and offering sympathy to the network administrator. Comparing servers to clients. What have they got that you don't got? Computer networks get a bad rap in the movies. In the 1980s, the Terminator movies featured Skynet, a computer network that becomes self-aware, a computer network of the future, takes over the planet, builds deadly Terminator robots, and sends them back through time to kill everyone unfortunate enough to have the name Sarah Connor. In the Matrix movies, a vast and powerful computer network enslaves humans and keeps them trapped in a simulation of the real world. And in the 2015 blockbuster Spectre, James Bond goes rogue, again, to prevent the evil genius Ernst Blofeld from taking over the world, again, by linking the computer systems of all the world's intelligence agencies together to form a single, all-powerful, evil network that spies on everybody. Fear not. These bad networks exist only in the dreams of science fiction writers. Real-world networks are much more calm and predictable. Although sophisticated networks do seem to know a lot about you, they don't think for themselves, and they don't evolve into self-awareness. And although they can gather a sometimes disturbing amount of information about you, they aren't trying to kill you, even if your name is Sarah Connor. Now that you're over your fear of networks, you're ready to breeze through this chapter. It's a gentle, even superficial introduction to computer networks, with a slant toward the concepts that can help you use a computer that's attached to a network. This chapter goes easy on the details. The detailed and boring stuff comes later. Defining a network. A network is nothing more than two or more computers connected by a cable, or by a wireless radio connection so that they can exchange information. Of course, computers can exchange information in ways other than networks. Most of us have used what computer nerds call the sneaker net. That's where you copy a file to a flash drive or other portable storage device, and then walk the data over to someone else's computer. The term sneaker net is typical of computer nerds' feeble attempts at humor. The whole problem with the sneaker net is that it's slow, and it wears a trail in your carpet. One day, some penny-pinching computer geeks discovered that connecting computers with cables was cheaper than replacing the carpet every 6 months. Thus, the modern computer network was born. You can create a simple computer network by hooking together all the computers in your office with cables and using the computer's network interface, an electronic circuit that resides inside your computer and has a special jack on the computer's backside. Then you tweak a few simple settings in the computer's operating system, OS, software, and voila, you have a working network. That's all there is to it. If you don't want to mess with cables, you can create a wireless network instead. In a wireless network, the computers use wireless network adapters that communicate via radio signals. All modern laptop computers have built-in wireless network adapters, as do most desktop computers. If yours doesn't, you can purchase a separate wireless network adapter that plugs into one of the computer's USB ports. Imagine a typical network with four computers. All four computers are connected by a network cable to a central network device, the switch. Imagine that Ward's computer has a fancy laser printer attached to it. Because of the network, June, Wally, and the Beaver can also use this laser printer. Also, the Beaver stuck yesterday's bubblegum to the back of his computer. Although the bubblegum isn't recommended, it shouldn't adversely affect the network. Computer networking has its own strange vocabulary. Although you don't have to know every esoteric networking term, it helps to be acquainted with a few of the basic buzzwords. LAN, LAN. Networks are often called LANs, short for Local Area Network. Technical stuff. LAN is the first TLA, or three-letter acronym, of this book. You don't really need to remember it or any of the many TLAs that follow. In fact, the only three-letter acronym you need to remember is TLA. You might guess that the acronym for four-letter acronym is FLA. Wrong! A four-letter acronym is an ETLA, which stands for Extended Three-Letter Acronym. After all, it just wouldn't be right if the acronym for four-letter acronym had only three letters. On the network. Every computer connected to the network is said to be on the network. The technical term, which you can forget, for a computer that's on the network is a node. Online, offline. When a computer is turned on and can access the network, the computer is online. When a computer can't access the network, it's offline. A computer can be offline for several reasons. The computer can be turned off. The user may have disabled the network connection. The computer may be broken. The cable that connects it to the network can be unplugged. Or a wad of gum can be jammed into the disk drive. Up, down. When a computer is turned on and working properly, it's up. When a computer is turned off, broken, or being serviced, it's down. Turning off a computer is sometimes called taking it down. Turning it back on is sometimes called bringing it up. Local, remote. A resource such as a disk drive is local if it resides in your computer. It's remote if it resides in another computer somewhere else on your network. Intranet. The internet is a huge amalgamation of computer networks strewn about the entire planet. Networking the computers in your home or office so that they can share information with one another and connecting your computer to the World Wide Internet are two separate but related tasks. Why bother with a network? Frankly, computer networks are a bit of a pain to set up, so why bother? Because the benefits of having a network outweigh the difficulties of setting up one. You don't have to be a PhD to understand the benefits of networking. In fact, you learned everything you need to know in kindergarten. Networks are all about sharing. Specifically, networks are about sharing three things: files, resources, and programs. Sharing files. Networks enable you to share information with other computers on the network. Depending on how you set up your network, you can share files with your network friends in several different ways. You can send a file from your computer directly to a friend's computer by attaching the file to an email message and then mailing it. Or you can let your friend access your computer over the network so that your friend can retrieve the file directly from your hard drive. Yet another method is to copy the file to a disk on another computer and then tell your friend where you put the file so that your friend can retrieve it later. One way or the other, the data travels to your friend's computer over the network cable and not on a CD or DVD or flash drive, as it would in a sneaker net. Sharing resources. You can set up certain computer resources, such as hard drives or printers, so that all computers on the network can access them. For example, the laser printer attached to Ward's computer is a shared resource, which means that anyone on the network can use it. Without the network, June, Wally, and the Beaver would have to buy their own laser printers. Hard drives can be shared resources, too. In fact, you must set up a hard drive as a shared resource to share files with other users. Suppose that Wally wants to share a file with the Beaver, and a shared hard drive has been set up on June's computer. All Wally has to do is copy his file to the shared hard drive in June's computer and tell the Beaver where he put it. Then, when the Beaver gets around to it, he can copy the file from June's computer to his own. Unless, of course, that hooligan Eddie Haskell deletes the file first. Tip: you can share other resources too, such as an internet connection. In fact, sharing an internet connection is one of the main reasons why many networks are created. Sharing programs. Rather than keep separate copies of programs on each person's computer, putting programs on a drive that everyone shares is sometimes best. For example, if 10 computer users all use a particular program, you can purchase and install 10 copies of the program, one for each computer. Or you can purchase a 10-user license for the program and then install just one copy of the program on a shared drive. Each of the 10 users can then access the program from the shared hard drive. In most cases, however, running a shared copy of a program over the network is unacceptably slow. A more common way of using a network to share programs is to copy the program's installation disks or CDs to a shared network drive. Then you can use that copy to install a separate copy of the program on each user's local hard drive. For example, Microsoft Office enables you to do this if you purchase a license from Microsoft for each computer on which you install Office. The advantage of installing Office from a shared network drive is that you don't have to lug around the installation disks or CDs to each user's computer. And the system administrator can customize the network installation so that the software is installed the same way on each user's computer. However, these benefits are significant only for larger networks. If your network has fewer than about 10 computers, you're probably better off installing the program separately on each computer, directly from the installation disks or CDs. Warning! Remember that purchasing a single-user copy of a program and then putting it on a shared network drive so that everyone on the network can access it is illegal. If 5 people use the program, you need to either purchase 5 copies of the program or purchase a network license that specifically allows 5 or more users. Tip. That being said, many software manufacturers sell their software with a concurrent usage license, which means that you can install the software on as many computers as you want, but only a certain number of people can use the software at any given time. Usually, special licensing software that runs on one of the network's server computers keeps track of how many people are currently using the software. This type of license is frequently used with more specialized and expensive software, such as accounting systems or computer drafting systems. Another benefit of networking is that networks enable computer users to communicate with one another over the network. The most obvious way networks allow computer users to communicate is by passing messages back and forth, using email or instant messaging programs. Networks also offer other ways to communicate. For example, you can hold online meetings over the network. Network users who have inexpensive video cameras, webcams, attached to their computers can have video conferences. You can even play a friendly game of hearts over a network. During your lunch break, of course. Servers and clients. The network computer that contains the hard drives, printers, and other resources that are shared with other network computers is a server. This term comes up repeatedly, so you have to remember it. Write it on the back of your left hand. Any computer that's not a server is a client. You have to remember this term, too. Write it on the back of your right hand. Only 2 kinds of computers are on a network, servers and clients. Look at your left hand, and then look at your right hand. Don't wash your hands until you memorize these terms. The distinction between servers and clients in a network has parallels in sociology. In effect, a sort of class distinction between the haves and have-nots of computer resources. Usually, the most powerful and expensive computers in a network are the servers. There's a good technical reason. All users on the network share the server's resources. The cheaper and less powerful computers in a network are the clients. Clients are the computers used by individual users for everyday work. Because clients' resources don't have to be shared, they don't have to be as fancy. Most networks have more clients than servers. For example, a network with 10 clients can probably get by with 1 server. In many networks, a clean line of demarcation exists between servers and clients. In other words, a computer functions as either a server or a client, not both. For the sake of an efficient network, a server can't become a client, nor can a client become a server. Other, usually smaller networks can be more even-handed by allowing any computer in the network to be a server, and allowing any computer to be both server and client at the same time. Dedicated servers and peers. In some networks, a server computer is a server computer and nothing else. It's dedicated to the sole task of providing shared resources, such as hard drives and printers, to be accessed by the network client computers. This type of server is a dedicated server because it can perform no other task than network services. Some smaller networks take an alternative approach by enabling any computer on the network to function as both a client and a server. Thus, any computer can share its printers and hard drives with other computers on the network. And while a computer is working as a server, you can still use that same computer for other functions, such as word processing. This type of network is a peer-to-peer network, because all the computers are thought of as peers, or equals. Here are some points to ponder concerning the differences between dedicated server networks and peer-to-peer networks while you're walking the dog tomorrow morning. Peer-to-peer networking features are built into Windows. Thus, if your computer runs Windows, you don't have to buy any additional software to turn your computer into a server. All you have to do is enable the Windows server features. The network server features that are built into desktop versions of Windows, such as Windows 7 and 8, aren't particularly efficient because these versions of Windows weren't designed primarily to be network servers. Remember, if you dedicate a computer to the task of being a full-time server, use a special server operating system rather than the standard Windows desktop operating system. A server operating system is specifically designed to handle networking functions efficiently. The most commonly used server operating systems are the server versions of Windows. As of this writing, the current server version of Windows is Windows Server 2016. However, many companies still use the previous version, Windows Server 2012, and a few even use its predecessor, Windows Server 2008. Another popular server operating system is Linux. Linux is popular because it is free. However, it requires more expertise to set up than Windows Server. Many networks are both peer-to-peer and dedicated server networks at the same time. These networks have at least one server computer that runs a server operating system, such as Windows Server 2016, client computers that use the server features of Windows to share their resources with the network. Tip: besides being dedicated, your servers should also be sincere. What makes a network tick? To use a network, you don't really have to know much about how it works. Still, you may feel a little bit better about using the network if you realize that it doesn't work by voodoo. A network may seem like magic, but it isn't. The following list describes the inner workings of a typical network. Network interface. Inside any computer attached to a network is a special electronic circuit called the network interface. The network interface has either an external jack into which you can plug a network cable, or, in the case of a wireless network interface, an antenna. Network cable. The network cable physically connects the computers. It plugs into the network interface card, NIC, on the back of your computer. The type of network cable most commonly used is twisted pair cable, so named because it consists of several pairs of wires twisted together in a certain way. Twisted pair cable superficially resembles telephone cable. However, appearances can be deceiving. Most phone systems are wired using a lower grade of cable that doesn't work for networks. For the complete lowdown on networking cables, see Chapter 6. Tip: network cable isn't necessary when wireless networking is used. For more information about wireless networking, see Chapter 9. Network switch. Networks built with twisted pair cabling require one or more switches. A switch is a box with a bunch of cable connectors. Each computer on the network is connected by cable to the switch. The switch, in turn, connects all the computers to each other. Technical stuff. In the early days of twisted pair networking, devices known as hubs were used rather than switches. The term hub is sometimes used to refer to switches, but true hubs went out of style sometime around the turn of the century. Technical stuff? In networks with just a few computers, the network switch is often combined with another networking device called a router. A router is used to connect two networks. Typically, a router is used to connect your network to the internet. By combining a router and a switch in a single box, you can easily connect several computers to the internet and to each other. Network software. Of course, the software makes the network work. To make any network work, a whole bunch of software has to be set up just right. For peer-to-peer networking with Windows, you have to play with the control panel to get networking to work. And a network operating system, such as Windows Server 2016, requires a substantial amount of tweaking to get it to work just right. It's not a personal computer anymore. If I had to choose one point that I want you to remember from this chapter more than anything else, it's this. After you hook up your personal computer, PC, to a network, it's not a personal computer anymore. You're now part of a network of computers. And in a way, you've given up one of the key concepts that made PCs so successful in the first place, independence. I got my start in computers back in the days when mainframe computers ruled the roost. Mainframe computers are big, complex machines that used to fill entire rooms and had to be cooled with chilled water. My first computer was a water-cooled Binford Hex Core Model 2000. Arg, arg, arg. I'm not making up the part about the water. A plumber was often required to install a mainframe computer. In fact, the really big ones were cooled by liquid nitrogen. I am making up the part about the Binford Hex Core 2000. Mainframe computers required staffs of programmers and operators in white lab coats just to keep them running. The mainframes had to be carefully managed. A whole bureaucracy grew up around managing them. Mainframe computers used to be the dominant computers in the workplace. Personal computers changed all that. They took the computing power out of the big computer room and put it on the user's desktop, where it belongs. PCs severed the tie to the centralized control of the mainframe computer. With a PC, a user could look at the computer and say, "This is mine, all mine." Mainframes still exist, but they're not nearly as popular as they once were. But networks have changed everything all over again. In a way, it's a change back to the mainframe computer way of thinking. Central location, distributed resources. True, the network isn't housed in the basement and doesn't have to be installed by a plumber. But you can no longer think of your PC as your own. You're part of a network. And like the mainframe, the network has to be carefully managed. Here are several ways in which a network robs you of your independence. You can't just indiscriminately delete files from the network. They may not be yours. You're forced to be concerned about network security. For example, a server computer has to know who you are before it allows you to access its files. So, you have to know your user ID and password to access the network. This precaution prevents some 15-year-old kid from hacking his way into your office network by using its internet connection and stealing all your computer games. You may have to wait for shared resources. Just because Wally sends something to Ward's printer doesn't mean that it immediately starts to print. The Beav may have sent a 2-hour print job before that. Wally just has to wait. You may have to wait for access to documents. You may try to retrieve an Excel spreadsheet file from a network drive, only to discover that someone else is using it. Like Wally, you just have to wait. You don't have unlimited storage space. If you copy a 100 gigabyte video file to a server's drive, you may get calls later from angry coworkers complaining that no room is left on the server's drive for their important files. Your files can become infected from viruses given to you by someone over the network. You may then accidentally infect other network users. You have to be careful about saving sensitive files on the server. If you write an angry note about your boss and save it on the server's hard drive, your boss may find the memo and read it. The server computer must be up and running at all times. For example, if you turn Ward's computer into a server computer, Ward can't turn his computer off when he's out of the office. If he does, you can't access the files stored on his computer. If your computer is a server, you can't just turn it off when you're finished using it. Someone else may be accessing a file on your hard drive or printing on your printer. The network administrator. Because so much can go wrong, even with a simple network, designating one person as network administrator is important. This way, someone is responsible for making sure the network doesn't fall apart or get out of control. The network administrator doesn't have to be a technical genius. In fact, some of the best network administrators are complete idiots when it comes to technical stuff. What's important is that the administrator is organized. That person's job is to make sure that plenty of space is available on the file server, that the file server is backed up regularly, that new employees can access the network, among other tasks. The network administrator's job also includes solving basic problems that the users themselves can't solve, and knowing when to call in an expert when something really bad happens. It's a tough job, but somebody's got to do it. Here are a few tips that might help. Part 4 of this book is devoted entirely to the hapless network administrator. So if you're nominated, listen to the chapters in that part. If you're lucky enough that someone else is nominated, celebrate by buying her a copy of this audiobook. In small companies, picking the network administrator by drawing straws is common. The person who draws the shortest straw loses and becomes administrator. Of course, the network administrator can't be a complete technical idiot. I was lying about that. For those of you in Congress, the word is testifying. I exaggerated to make the point that organizational skills are more important than technical skills. The network administrator needs to know how to do various maintenance tasks. Although this knowledge requires at least a little technical know-how, the organizational skills are more important. What do they got that you don't got? With all this technical stuff to worry about, you may begin to wonder whether you're smart enough to use your computer after it's attached to the network. Let me assure you that you are. If you're smart enough to buy this book because you know that you need a network, you're more than smart enough to use the network after it's put in. You're also smart enough to install and manage a network yourself. It isn't rocket science. I know people who use networks all the time. They're no smarter than you are. But they do have one thing that you don't have: a certificate. And so, by the powers vested in me by the International Society for the Computer Impaired, I present you with a certificate confirming that you've earned the coveted title Certified Network Dummy, better known as CND. This title is considered much more prestigious in certain circles than the more stodgy CNE or MCSE badges worn by real network experts. Congratulations, and go in peace. Chapter 2. Life on the Network. In this chapter, Using Local Resources and Network Resources, playing the name game, logging onto a network, using shared folders, going places with networks, mapping your network drives, using a network printer, logging off the network. After you hook up your PC to a network, it's not an island anymore, separated from the rest of the world like some kind of isolationist fanatic waving a "Don't Tread on Me" flag. The network connection changes your PC forever. Now your computer is part of a system, connected to other computers on the network. You have to worry about annoying network details, such as using local and shared resources, logging on and accessing network drives, using network printers, logging off, and who knows what else. Oh, bother. This chapter brings you up to speed on what living with a computer network is like. Unfortunately, this chapter gets a little technical at times, so you may need your pocket protector. Distinguishing between local resources and network resources. In case you don't catch this statement in Chapter 1, one of the most important differences between using an isolated computer and using a network computer lies in the distinction between local resources and network resources. Local resources are items, such as hard drives, printers, and CD or DVD drives, that are connected directly to your computer. You can use local resources whether you're connected to the network or not. Network resources, on the other hand, are the hard drives, printers, optical drives, and other devices that are connected to the network's server computers. You can use network resources only after your computer is connected to the network. Whenever you use a computer network, you need to know which resources are local resources, belong to you, and which are network resources, belong to the network. In most networks, your C drive is a local drive, as is your My Documents folder. If a printer is sitting next to your PC, it's probably a local printer. You can do anything you want with these resources without affecting the network or other users on the network, as long as the local resources aren't shared on the network. Keep these points in mind. You can't tell just by looking at a resource whether it's a local resource or a network resource. The printer that sits right next to your computer is probably your local printer, but then again, it may be a network printer. The same statement is true for hard drives. The hard drive in your PC is probably your own, but it, or part of it, may be shared on the network, thus enabling other users to access it. Because dedicated network servers are full of resources, you may say that they're not only dedicated and sincere, but also resourceful. Groan. Sorry. This is yet another in a tireless series of bad computer nerd puns. What's in a name? Just about everything on a computer network has a name. The computers themselves have names. The people who use the computers have names. The hard drives and printers that can be shared on the network have names. And the network itself has a name. Knowing all the names used on your network isn't essential, but you do need to know some of them. Here are some additional details about network names. Every person who can use the network has a username, sometimes called a user ID. You need to know your username to log on to the network. You also need to know the usernames of your buddies, especially if you want to steal their files or send them nasty notes. You can find more information about usernames and logging on in the section Logging On to the Network later in this chapter. Warning! Letting folks on the network use their first names as their usernames is tempting, but not a good idea. Even in a small office, you eventually run into a conflict. And what about Mrs. McCabe, made famous by Dr. Seuss, who had 23 children and named them all Dave? Tip: create a consistent way of creating usernames. For example, you may use your first name plus the first two letters of your last name. Then, Wally's username is Wally CL, and Beaver's is Beaver CL. Or you may use the first letter of your first name followed by your complete last name. Then, Wally's username is W Cleaver, and Beaver's is B Cleaver. In most networks, capitalization doesn't matter in usernames. Thus, B Cleaver all in lowercase is the same as B Cleaver with uppercase B, uppercase C. Every computer on the network must have a unique computer name. Tip: you don't have to know the names of all the computers on the network, but it helps if you know your own computer's name and the names of any server computers you need to access. The computer's name is sometimes the same as the username of the person who uses the computer, but that's usually a bad idea because in many companies, people come and go more often than computers. Sometimes the names indicate the physical location of the computer, such as office-12 or back room. Server computers often have names that reflect the group that uses the server most, like ACCTNG-server or CAD-server. Some network nerds like to assign techie-sounding names, like BL3K5-87A. And some like to use names from science fiction movies. HAL, Colossus, M5, and Data come to mind. Cute names like Herbie aren't allowed. However, Tigger and Pooh are entirely acceptable. Recommended, in fact. Networks are what Tiggers like the best. Remember, usually the sensible approach to computer naming is to use names that have numbers, such as Computer 001 or Computer 002. Network resources, such as shared disk folders and printers, have names. For example, a network server may have two printers, named Laser and Inkjet, to indicate the type of printer, and two shared disk folders named Accounting Data and Marketing Data. Server-based networks have a username for the network administrator. Tip: if you log on using the administrator's username, you can do anything you want. Add new users, define new network resources, change Wally's password, anything. The administrator's username is usually something clever, such as administrator. The network itself has a name. Remember, the Windows world has two basic types of networks. Domain networks are the norm for large corporate environments that have dedicated servers with IT staff to maintain them. Work group networks are more common in homes or in small offices that don't have dedicated servers or IT staff. A domain network is known by, you guessed it, a domain name. And a work group network is identified by, drumroll please, a work group name. Regardless of which type of network you use, you need to know this name to gain access to the network. Logging on to the network. To use network resources, you must connect your computer to the network, and you must go through the super secret process of logging on, which is how you let the network know who you are so that it can decide whether you're one of the good guys. Logging on is a little bit like cashing a check. You must have two forms of identification: your username, the name by which the network knows you. Your username is usually some variation of your real name, like Beav for the Beaver. Remember, Everyone who uses the network must have a username. And remember your password, a secret word that only you and the network know. If you type the correct password, the network believes that you are who you say you are. Every user has a different password, and the password should be a secret. In the early days of computer networking, you had to type a logon command at a stark MS-DOS prompt and then supply your user ID and password. Nowadays, the glory of Windows is that you get to log on to the network through a special network logon screen. Tip: here are some more logon points to ponder. The terms user ID and logon name are sometimes used instead of username. They all mean the same thing. As long as we're talking about words that mean the same thing, login and logon mean the same thing, as do, respectively, log out and log off, as ways of saying, I'm out of here. Although you see both out there in the world, this book uses log on and log off throughout, and if there's any exception, the book says why and grouses about it a bit. As far as the network's concerned, you and your computer aren't the same thing. Your username refers to you, not to your computer. That's why you have a username, and your computer has a computer name. You can log on to the network by using your username from any computer that's attached to the network. Other users can log on at your computer by using their own usernames. When others log on at your computer by using their own usernames, they can't access any of your network files that are protected by your password. However, they can access any local files that you haven't protected. Be careful which people you allow to use your computer. If you're logging on to a domain network on a Windows computer, you must type the domain name before your username, separated from it by a backslash. For example, lowwriter/dlow. Here, the domain name is lowwriter, and the username is dlow. Note that Windows remembers the domain and username from your last login, so ordinarily all you have to enter is your password. To log on to a different domain, or as a different user, you must click Switch User. Then you can click the other user icon and enter a different domain name and username, along with the password for the user you want to log on as. On an older Windows XP system, the logon dialog box has a field in which you can enter the domain name you want to log on to. Your computer may be set up so that it logs you on automatically whenever you turn it on. In that case, you don't have to type your username and password. This setup makes the task of logging on more convenient, but takes the sport out of it. And it's a terrible idea if you're the least bit worried about bad guys getting into your network or personal files. Guard your password with your life. I'd tell you mine, but then I'd have to shoot you. Understanding shared folders. Long ago, in the days before network, BN, your computer probably just had one hard drive, known as the C drive. Maybe it had two, C and D. The second drive might be another hard disk or possibly a CD-ROM or DVD-ROM drive. Even to this day, the descendants of those drives are physically located inside your PC. They are your local drives. Now that you're on a network, however, you may have access to drives that aren't located inside your PC, but are located instead in one of the other computers on the network. These network drives can be located on a dedicated server computer, or, in the case of a peer-to-peer network, on another client computer. In some cases, you can access an entire network drive over the network, but in most cases, you can't access the entire drive. Instead, you can access only certain folders on the network drives. Either way, the shared drives or folders are known in Windows terminology as shared folders. Here's where it gets confusing. The most common way to access a shared folder is to assign a drive letter to it. Suppose that a server has a shared folder named Marketing. You can assign drive letter M to this shared folder. Then you access the Marketing folder as drive M. The M drive is then called a network drive because it uses the network to access data in a shared folder. Assigning a drive letter to a shared folder is mapping a drive. Shared folders can be set up with restrictions on how you can use them. For example, you may be granted full access to some shared folders so that you can copy files to or from them, delete files on them, or create or remove folders on them. On other shared folders, your access may be limited in certain ways. For example, you may be able to copy files to or from the shared folder, but not delete files, edit files, or create new folders. You may also be asked to enter a password before you can access a protected folder. The amount of disk space you're allowed to use on a shared folder may also be limited. For more information about file sharing restrictions, see Chapter 13. Tip: in addition to accessing shared folders that reside on other people's computers, you can designate your computer as a server to enable other network users to access folders that you share. To find out how to share folders on your computer with other network users, see Chapter 3. Four good uses for a shared folder. After you know which shared network folders are available, you may wonder what you're supposed to do with them. This section describes four good uses for a network folder. Store files that everybody needs. A shared network folder is a good place to store files that more than one user needs to access. Without a network, you have to store a copy of the file on everyone's computer, and you have to worry about keeping the copies synchronized, which you can't do, no matter how hard you try. Or you can keep the file on a disk and pass it around. Or you can keep the file on one computer and play musical chairs. Whenever someone needs to use the file, he goes to the computer that contains the file. On a network, you can keep one copy of the file in a shared folder on the network, and everyone can access it. Store your own files. You can also use a shared network folder as an extension of your own hard drive storage. For example, if you filled up all the free space on your hard drive with pictures, sounds, and movies that you downloaded from the internet, but the network server has billions and billions of gigabytes of free space, you have all the drive space you need. Just store your files on the network drive. Here are a few guidelines for storing files on network drives. Using the network drive for your own files works best if the network drive is set up for private storage that other users can't access. That way, you don't have to worry about the nosy guy down in accounting who likes to poke around in other people's files. Don't overuse the network drive. Remember that other users have probably filled up their own hard drives, so they want to use the space on the network drive too. Before you store personal files on a network drive, make sure that you have permission. A note from your mom will do. On domain networks, a drive, typically drive H, is commonly mapped to a user's home folder. The home folder is a network folder that's unique for each user. You can think of it as a network version of My Documents. If your network is set up with a home folder, use it rather than My Documents for any important work-related files. That's because the home folder is usually included in the network's daily backup schedule. By contrast, most networks do not backup data you store in My Documents. make a temporary resting place for files on their way to other users. Hey, Wally, could you send me a copy of last month's baseball stats? Sure, Beav. But how? If the baseball stats file resides on Wally's local drive, how does Wally send a copy of the file to Beaver's computer? Wally can do it by copying the file to a network drive, then Beaver can copy the file to his local hard drive. Here are some tips to keep in mind when you use a network drive to exchange files with other network users. Remember to delete files that you saved to the network drive after they're picked up. Otherwise, the network drive quickly fills up with unnecessary files. Create a folder on the network drive specifically intended for holding files en route to other users. I like to name this folder Pit Stop. Tip: in many cases, it's easier to send files to other network users by email than by using a network folder. Just send a message to the other network user and attach the file you want to share. The advantage of sending a file by email is that you don't have to worry about details like where to leave the file on the server and who's responsible for deleting the file. Back up your local hard drive. If enough drive space is available on the file server, you can use it to store backup copies of the files on your hard drive. Just copy the files that you want to back up to a shared network folder. Obviously, if you copy all your data files to the network drive, and everybody else follows suit, it can fill up quickly. Check with the network manager before you start storing backup copies of your files on the server. The manager may have already set up a special network drive that's designed just for backups. And if you're lucky, your network manager may be able to set up an automatic backup schedule for your important data so that you don't have to remember to back it up manually. I hope that your network administrator also routinely backs up the contents of the network server's disk to tape. Yes, tape. See Chapter 20 for details. That way, if something happens to the network server, the data can be recovered from the backup tapes. Oh, the network places you'll go. Windows enables you to access network resources, such as shared folders, by browsing the network. In Windows 7, choose Network from the Start menu. In Windows 8, 8.1, and 10, open Windows Explorer. Click File Explorer on the taskbar, and then click Network. As an example, after you do this, the network consists of just two computers, the desktop client computer running Windows 10, Win10-01, and a server computer running Windows Server 2016, Win1601. In an actual network, you would obviously see more than just two computers. You can open a computer by double-clicking its icon to reveal a list of shared resources available on the computer. You can also browse the network from any Windows application program. For example, you may be working with Microsoft Word and want to open a document file that's stored in a shared folder on your network. All you have to do is use the Open command to bring up the dialog box and then choose Network in the navigation pane to view the available network devices. Mapping network drives. Tip: if you often access a particular shared folder, you may want to use the special trick known as mapping to access the shared folder more efficiently. Mapping assigns a drive letter to a shared folder. Then you can use the drive letter to access the shared folder as though it were a local drive. In this way, you can access the shared folder from any Windows program without having to browse the network. For example, you can map a shared folder named Data on the server named Win1601 to drive K on your computer. Then, to access files stored in the shared data folder, you look on drive K. To map a shared folder to a drive letter, follow these steps. 1. Open File Explorer. Windows 7, choose Start and then Computer. Windows 8, 8.1 and 10, open the desktop and click the File Explorer icon on the taskbar, and then click Computer in the location list on the left side of the screen. 2. Open the Map Network Drive dialog box. Windows 7, access this dialog by clicking the Map Network Drive button located on the toolbar. Windows 8 and 8.1, click Map Network Drive on the ribbon. Windows 10, click the Computer tab, and then click Map Network Drive. 3. Optional. Change the drive letter in the drive drop-down list. You probably don't have to change the drive letter that Windows selects. If you're picky, though, you can select the drive letter from the drive drop-down list. 4. Click the Browse button. 5. Use the Browse for Folder dialog box to find and select the shared folder you want to use. You can navigate to any shared folder on any computer in the network. 6. Click OK. The Browse for Folder dialog box is dismissed, and you return to the Map Network Drive dialog box. 7. Optional. If you want this network drive to be automatically mapped each time you log on to the network, select the Reconnect at Sign-In checkbox. If you leave the Reconnect at Sign-In checkbox deselected, the drive letter is available only until you shut down Windows or log out of the network. If you select this option, the network drive reconnects automatically each time you log on to the network. Tip: be sure to select the Reconnect at Sign-In checkbox if you use the network drive often. 8. Click OK. You return to the This PC folder. Here, you can see the newly mapped network drive. Your network administrator may have already set up your computer with one or more mapped network drives. If so, you can ask her to tell you which network drives have been mapped. Or you can just open the This PC folder and have a look. Here are a few additional tips. Assigning a drive letter to a network drive is called mapping the drive, or linking the drive, by network nerds. Drive Q is mapped to a network drive, they say. Network drive letters don't have to be assigned the same way for every computer on the network. For example, a network drive that's assigned drive letter M on your computer may be assigned drive letter Z on someone else's computer. In that case, your drive M and the other computer's drive Z refer to the same data. This arrangement can be confusing. If your network is set up this way, put pepper in your network administrator's coffee. Accessing a shared network folder through a mapped network drive is much faster than accessing the same folder by browsing the network. Windows has to browse the entire network to list all available computers whenever you browse the network. By contrast, Windows doesn't have to browse the network to access a mapped network drive. If you select the Reconnect at Sign-In option for a mapped drive, you receive a warning message if the drive isn't available when you log on. In most cases, the problem is that the server computer isn't turned on. Sometimes, however, this message is caused by a broken network connection. For more information about fixing network problems such as this one, see Chapter 19. Using a network printer. Using a network printer is much like using a network hard drive. You can print to a network printer from any Windows program by choosing the print command to call up a print dialog box from any program, and choosing a network printer from the list of available printers. Keep in mind, however, that printing on a network printer isn't exactly the same as printing on a local printer. You have to take turns. When you print on a local printer, you're the only one using it. When you print to a network printer, however, you are, in effect, standing in line behind other network users, waiting to share the printer. This line complicates the situation in several ways. If several users print to the network printer at the same time, the network has to keep the print jobs separate from one another. If it didn't, the result would be a jumbled mess, with your 268-page report getting mixed in with the payroll checks. That would be bad. Fortunately, the network takes care of this situation by using the fancy print spooling feature. Network printing works on a first-come, first-served basis. Invariably, when I get in line at the hardware store, the person in front of me is trying to buy something that doesn't have a product code on it. I end up standing there for hours, waiting for someone in plumbing to pick up the phone for a price check. Network printing can be like that. If someone sends a 2-hour print job to the printer before you send your half-page memo, you have to wait. You may have access to a local printer and several network printers. Before you were forced to use the network, your computer probably had just one printer attached to it. You may want to print some documents on your cheap, local inkjet printer, but use the network laser printer for important stuff. To do that, you have to find out how to use your program's functions for switching printers. Adding a network printer. Before you can print to a network printer, you have to configure your computer to access the network printer that you want to use. From the Start menu, open the Control Panel, and then double-click the Printers icon. If your computer is already configured to work with a network printer, an icon for the network printer appears in the Printers folder. You can tell a network printer from a local printer by the shape of the printer icon. Network printer icons have a pipe attached to the bottom of the printer. If you don't have a network printer configured for your computer, you can add one by using the Add Printer wizard. Just follow these steps. 1. Open the Control Panel. Windows 7 or earlier, choose Start, and then Control Panel. Windows 8 and later, press the Windows key, type Control, and then click the Control Panel icon. 2. Click Devices and Printers. 3. Click the Add a Printer button on the toolbar. This step starts the Add Printer wizard. 4. Click the printer you want to use. Tip: if you can't find the printer you want to use, ask your network administrator for the printer's UNC path, which is the name used to identify the printer on the network, or its IP address. Then click, "The printer that I want isn't listed," and enter the UNC or IP address for the printer when prompted. 5. Click Next to add the printer. The wizard copies to your computer the correct printer driver for the network printer. You may be prompted to confirm that you want to add the driver. If so, click Install Driver to proceed. The Add Printer wizard displays a screen that shows the printer's name and asks whether you want to designate the printer as your default printer. 6. Optional. Designate the printer as your default printer. 7. Click Next to continue. A final confirmation dialog box is displayed. 8. Click Finish. You're done. Tip: many network printers, especially newer ones, are connected directly to the network by using a built-in Ethernet card. Setting up these printers can be tricky. You may need to ask the network administrator for help in setting up this type of printer. Some printers that are connected directly to the network have their own web addresses, such as printer.cleaverfamily.com. If that's the case, you can often set up the printer in a click or two. Use your browser to go to the printer's webpage and then click a link that enables you to install the printer. Printing to a network printer. After you install the network printer in Windows, printing to the network printer is a snap. You can print to the network printer from any Windows program by using the print command to summon the print dialog box, which is usually found on the file menu. The available printers are listed near the top of this dialog box. Choose the network printer from this list and then click OK to print your document. That's all there is to it. Playing with the print queue. After you send your document to a network printer, you usually don't have to worry about it. You just go to the network printer and voila, your printed document is waiting for you. That's what happens in the ideal world. In the real world, where you and I live, all sorts of things can happen to your print job between the time you send it to the network printer and the time it prints. You discover that someone else already sent a 50 trillion page report ahead of you that isn't expected to finish printing until the national debt is paid off. The price of a Framus valve suddenly goes up by $2, rendering foolish the recommendations you made in your report. Your boss calls and tells you that his brother-in-law will be attending the meeting, so won't you please print an extra copy of the proposal for him? Oh, and a photocopy won't do. Originals only, please. You decide to take lunch, so you don't want the output to print until you get back. Fortunately, your print job isn't totally beyond your control just because you already sent it to the network printer. You can easily change the status of jobs that you already sent. You can change the order in which jobs print, hold a job so that it doesn't print until you say so, or cancel a job. You can probably make your network print jobs do other tricks, too. Shake hands, roll over, and play dead. But the basic tricks, hold, cancel, and change the print order, are enough to get you started. To play with the printer queue, open the control panel by pressing Start and then Control Panel in Windows 7 or earlier, or press the Windows key, type Control, and then click the control panel icon. Then click Devices and Printers, and double-click the icon for the printer that you want to manage. You can see that just one document has been sent to the printer. To manipulate the print jobs that appear in the print queue, or in the printer itself, use these tricks. To temporarily stop a job from printing, select the job and choose Document, and then pause printing. Choose the same command again to release the job from its state of frustration and print it out already. To delete a print job, select the job and choose Document and then cancel printing. To stop the printer, choose Printer and then pause printing. To resume, choose the command again. To delete all print jobs, choose Printer and then purge print documents. To cut to the front of the line, drag to the top of the list the print job that you want to print. All these tips apply to your print jobs only. Unfortunately, you can't capriciously delete other people's print jobs. The best thing about Windows printer management is that it shelters you from the details of working with different network operating systems. Whether you print on a NetWare printer, a Windows 2003 network printer, or a shared Windows printer, the printer window icon manages all print jobs in the same way. Logging off the network. After you finish using the network, log off. Logging off the network makes the network drives and printers unavailable. Your computer is still physically connected to the network. Unless you cut the network cable with pruning shears, it's a bad idea, don't do it. But the network and its resources are unavailable to you. Here are a few other tips to keep in mind when you log off. After you turn off your computer, you're automatically logged off the network. After you start your computer, you have to log on again. Remember, logging off the network is a good idea if you're going to leave your computer unattended for a while. As long as your computer is logged into the network, anyone can use it to access the network. And because unauthorized users can access it under your user ID, you get the blame for any damage they do. In Windows, you can log off the network by clicking the Start button and choosing the Log Off command. This process logs you off the network without restarting Windows. In Windows 7, click Start and then click the right-facing arrow that appears next to the little padlock icon. In Windows 8 and later, press Ctrl-Alt-Delete and then choose Sign Out. Chapter 3. More ways to use your network. In this chapter,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.